We could go ahead and call the meeting to order. I believe, I guess we have a quorum for the Strategic Options Group, and I don't know, some of the physicians may come in a bit. I want to thank everybody for coming. And tonight we have Community Health Systems, and we appreciate you all coming down here tonight on this rainy day to discuss with us your viewpoints on the hospital here. Before we do that, let's, as a group, we'll go around one by one and introduce ourselves so that you know who is sitting at the table. And we'll start with Joe Hanratty.
Mike Jordan, I'm one of the trustees at the hospital.
David Cope, trustee.
Mel Seek, I'm a nephrologist, critical care medicine, and a member of the strategic committee.
Larry Strack, trustee.
Randy Klein, attorney, just interested in the hospital.
John Kurtz, trustee.
Steve Purvis, president and CEO here at Monroe. Welcome back.
Rich Mutarelli, executive vice president, CFO.
Hi, good afternoon. Paul Clark, Chief Operating Officer. Welcome.
Casey Nolan with Navigant Consulting.
Ebla Master with Ponder.
And Dave Atchison with Ponder.
Hi, I'm Shan Carpenter, VP of Finance for Division One.
Hi, I'm Ken King. I'm VP of Acquisitions for CHS, Community Health Systems.
I'm Barbara Paul. I'm the Chief Medical Officer for Community Health Systems.
David Miller, Division President for Community Health Systems.
Thank you very much. The process where we've gone through, there's a repeat of last night. Still a new process for all of us, besides the members of the Options Committee and management of the hospital, and then people from from Community Health Systems. We have other members of the hospital management team, and we also have people from our community who have this vested interest in the decisions that are being made today. During the process, we'll have a 45-minute presentation by the hospital. We'll have 45 minutes of questions and answers by members of the Strategic Options Committee. We will then have 10 minutes, give or take, of comments and questions from the audience. And do we have a sign-in sheet,
yes, sir,
in the back? At which time the Strategic Options Committee will just be debriefing themselves on the various discussions we've had with the hospital. And while it is a public meeting and you are legally entitled to stay, I would ask, which I believe I'm able to, that you not participate. We can't force you out, and I guess but it would be helpful just so we can discuss openly with the public here what we're discussing, and I believe that's equitable, John. So that would be, I guess, your choice. Let me turn the presentation over to Community Health Systems. And I'll leave it up to you to do the order and presentation in the order you'd like. And we'll try to hold questions. If there's a specific question that comes to mind during your presentation, I guess it would be appropriate to ask, or just make the note so we're not in the middle of a 20 minutes presentation and then all of a sudden it's thrown off so far. So maybe we could hold questions till after you're through with your discussion. So I will turn it over to you. Thank you.
Open up here a little bit. Again, my name is Ken King. I'm the VP of Acquisitions for Community Health Systems, and I just want to introduce my team in a little bit more detail. Mr. Miller, Mr. David Miller, and Dr. Paul are going to do the bulk of the presentation today, and I promise we'll get through it as quickly as we can. We only have this much presentation material to go through, and I understand the presidential debates are at 8 o'clock, so we might make that, hopefully, but no, I'm just kidding. We have about 20 pages of presentation material for you this evening. And let me just introduce my team a little bit better. To my far right is Mr. David Miller. He is division president for CHS. He's been in this industry for well over 35 years, probably closer to 40 years, and has worked on, you know, both the not-for-profit side as well as the investor-owned side. He's been with CHS for over 15 years and has had CEO jobs, just like Mr. Purvis down here. So he's risen up through the ranks, and so he will be opening up our presentation. Dr. Paul has been with our company for a little over 4 years. She is board certified internist, received her education and training and at Stanford, and practiced in internal medicine for 12 years in Northern California, and then got the bug to be involved in policy making and went to work for the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, the program that oversees both Medicare and Medicaid. And while at CMS, she was involved in you know, many projects, some to attempt to eliminate some of the red tape that, you know, physicians incur, other projects to raise quality at hospitals, and she was involved in some of the pay for performance initiatives that are going on at CMS. I've always been a development guy, so you know, my job is to go out and develop relationships with hospital. Shan has a finance and accounting background and has risen up through the ranks with hospitals in accounting and finance positions, and is now the VP of Finance for the Division One. I'm going to let Mr. Miller talk a little bit more when I refer to Division One, what that means and what he's responsible for. But anyway, just wanted to give you a little bit more background about our team, and I will now turn it over to Mr. David Miller.
Thank you, Ken. Thank you to the folks from Ocala for having us here for a second visit. We were here in June, where your team presented to us the current state of the world in Ocala. When I returned back to Nashville, I always do a trip report. And I've participated in a number of acquisition opportunities in my 15 years with CHS, and this one was truly unique. As we sat here towards the end of the day with your senior management team, as they reviewed their financial situation and the challenges that you all face, I was struck by probably one thing more than anything else, and that was transparency. I've done a lot of these, as I said, and I've never had a team that was as open as your team was. I think that speaks well for the community, the board, and this specific hospital, because if you enter into a dialogue with a potential partner with that type of candor, the likelihood of you finding the correct partner, in my mind, is greatly enhanced. So we appreciated very much that first day that we spent here earlier last summer. As Ken said, I'm the Division One president. We have about 135 hospitals in our system. We're organized into five divisions. Those divisions are pretty much geographic. Division One is the southeastern part of the United States, 25 hospitals in seven states. We start in Virginia, come down the coast to Florida, and over to Mississippi. So I like to think that my job is a little bit easier because my travel's easier than some of my colleagues that have to travel to Alaska or California. But also, I think the composition of the 25 hospitals in Division One, the social, cultural priorities are so similar that it makes my job a little bit easier. So that, too, is another reason why the Ocala opportunity is so attractive to us. The first slide is really our attempt to give an overview of the company. Our corporate officers would tell you that we operate from a philosophy of creating great places for patients to receive care, physicians to practice medicine, and people to work. Those three stakeholders are critically important to the success we've enjoyed in this company. The company was founded in 1985. Was public on the New York Stock Exchange in 1996 and went private. Forstmann Little out of New York purchased the company, took it private. At that point in time, they put in a new management team, Wayne Smith being the CEO, and I was the first operating officer that Wayne Smith hired after he was named CEO. And the senior management team, for all intents and purposes, has been together now for 15 years. And that sort of stability has been critically important to our success. In our industry, executives in the healthcare arena move through the hierarchy of professional challenges quite readily, but it's important to a community hospital, from our way of thinking, that the senior management team is consistent so that if you ever have an issue at the local level, there is an executive that you've seen before, you've worked with before, you've come to trust, hopefully, that can answer any concerns that you would have. When I joined the company, we were mid-30s in hospitals at about $600 million in net revenue. Today, we're 135 hospitals and nearly $14 billion in revenue. We have 675,000 annual admissions in our system, and our average daily census is about 8,000. And to put that in perspective, at any given day in the calendar year, about 2% of the U.S. population that's hospitalized is hospitalized in a CHS hospital. So we're a significant player in the marketplace. We have 90,000 employees across our system. Obviously, that includes some part-timers. And we have 16,000 members on our various medical staffs. When I joined the company, we probably had about 300 or 400 employed physicians. Today, we have nearly 3,000 employed physicians in our system. And as we have been successful, and we'll show you later slide with our physician recruiting, I have found over that 15-year time that on the front end with CHS, probably 10% of the physicians we recruited wanted to be employed. Today, last year, 65% of the physicians we recruit are looking for an employment model. And you might ask yourself, well, why has that changed? Well, the complexities of the marketplace, physicians want to minimize their risk. They're not especially interested in the back office or financial aspects of practice. They rather do the clinical side of it. And then also, candidly, the younger physicians are looking for lifestyle changes so that they can more clearly define how their work week goes and their time between family and work is more balanced, perhaps, than historically it was. So we've had to change with the cultural changes and make sure that when we recruit physicians, we put them in successful positions in our communities. Here's a map that shows our spread. Now, we have 29 states that are represented by our owned hospitals. But I also want to point out to you that in the United States, we have another 150-plus hospitals that we have management agreements with. So again, our footprint is pretty broad across the country, and we're able to access information from virtually any state in the country about what's going on in healthcare, and then tabulate that information and then make sure that the processes that we implement across our system are successful, or at least have the highest probability of being successful. I'm going to show you one slide with two different slides on it that relate to our company's financial performance. The first slide on the left is the revenues, and it shows from 1996 through 2011, the last full fiscal year that we have, our compound annual growth rate has been 23% in revenue. Clearly on the front end, when we were a much smaller company and doing acquisitions, each acquisition meant a meaningful increase in our revenues. But still, when we completed the Triad acquisition in July of 2007, and when we did that transaction, that company was actually bigger than we were. We acquired them, and we have still been able to maintain a revenue stream increase of about 8%. At the same time, what we measure free cash flow, we refer to it as EBITDA. Our EBITDA compound annual growth rate has been 21% for the last 15 years. And also, you will note that it's about 6.5% for the past several years. One of the things we're always asked when we come into a community is, what is your commitment? What will you do to the less fortunate people in the community? This bar graph here is an attempt to explain to you our huge commitment to uncompensated care. In our company last year, you will note that we spent almost $3.1 billion that we were not reimbursed for. This is a combination of bad debts, people who refuse to pay their bills, charity care, people who can't, and then administrative discounts where we work with people who have no insurance and are paying their bills on their own, and we make administrative discounts. So that $3.1 billion is about a little over 21% of our net revenue. So again, in our minds, we feel like we're doing our fair share to ensure that everybody has access to acute care hospital services in those communities that we serve. We follow analysts every day, and I just thought it would be important to share with you what one senior analyst from Baird has to say about the marketplace that you find yourselves in today, and that virtually every hospital in the United States finds themselves in today. And this is a direct quote from his analyst report just 3 weeks ago. Healthcare providers face tremendous challenges exacerbated by macroeconomic and reform uncertainty. Competition for patients and staff is fierce. Regulatory oversight and demands astounding and mounting. Costs are rising while reimbursement is declining, and medical error liability is growing. Again, this is from Mr. Caldwell. We believe healthcare providers are at a critical juncture today, and companies that are able to lower expenses, increase patient revenue, and improve clinical outcomes have a unique opportunity to help their hospital and ambulatory customers mitigate the financial challenges ahead and capture reimbursement and stimulus-related opportunities. So if perchance some people in the audience feel like the situation in Ocala is different than the rest of the world, it's really not. The challenges today are nationwide, and they affect every community. Healthcare continues to be a local business, but each locale in this country is struggling with exactly the same set of operational problems. Our organizational strategy is rather simple. We attempt to combine community-based healthcare with the resources required for growth and success. And our organization embraces a model of service culture called Community Cares. We have been a partner with the Studer Group for over 5 years, and that partnership has been instrumental in our ability to push forward and upward, not only our financial results, but our clinical results, which we'll share with you later. In effect, what we try and do is we take an acquisition, we begin to integrate it into our system. We recruit quality primary care physicians and specialists. We expand services, we increase ER patient visits, and we improve operations. It's not rocket science, but we are very disciplined operators, and we have been able to effectively implement change in all these institutions that we associate with to push the ball forward. Sometimes I try and get this a little bit philosophical with the men and women that work for me in Division One. And I said to them earlier this year, I try and put a challenge out to them each year, that for us, what we're trying to do is continue the journey of differentiating CHS and CHS facilities from their peer group. And there are two simple ways that you do that. You build lasting, strategic relationships with our physician partners, and you connect with our patient base so that we become the resource for all the healthcare needs, whether we deliver those needs or not. We want each resident in the community where we have a facility to see the CHS hospital as the resource to go to for advice and counsel as it relates to a healthcare need. We also meet regularly with our CEOs, and we try and map out for them each year pretty succinctly how they can be successful in the marketplace. This year, we identified 7 items for the 2012 year that we feel will help us be successful. The first and most important was to execute the physician recruiting plans that each one of our facilities have. Secondly, we had to perfect the case management process in each institution. In today's reimbursement climate, you absolutely have to match resources appropriately with the patient in coordination with the physician who's orchestrating the care. To be successful, you also have to instill operating expense management consciousness. That's one thing that I believe our company does better than any other company in the industry. And a new initiative for us this year is to create high reliability, patient safety first culture. And again, we'll touch on that a little later in the presentation, where we've gone with a national partner. And what we are going to attempt to do in CHS is bring to our system of hospitals the same degree of reliability and outcomes that one would find in commercial aviation or if you ran a nuclear power plant. And in those particular entities, it's not 99% accuracy, it's 99.9.9.9. You have to get it that way. When patients come into our doors, and if it's their mom, their dad, the expectation is that we will get it right every single time. And that's what I think our industry is being pushed to deliver, and we think we have a formula to do that. We also understand there's a huge challenge with the technology world that we face today. Meaningful uses out there, there's a huge amount of dollars that people are chasing. But beyond the dollars that people are chasing is we have got to, as a system, be able to accumulate data and find those areas that give us opportunities to improve our clinical performance. So that's a huge challenge. It's not an easy one. Again, when we visited last June, you folks were facing that same challenge. We're big, but we still have that same sort of challenge. As we implement automated medical records in our clinics, and electronic medical records in our hospitals. We also need to stay connected to our customer. And we have two programs right now. We're about to embark on a third one. We call them discharge callbacks and provider callbacks. We attempt to call back more than 80% of the patients that visit our emergency rooms. And we have been successful last year with that. We made over 1 million calls to our patients that came in our ERs to make sure that not only did they get the right care, but they also were able to access the post-hospital visit care that was required or ordered by their physician. Their provider callbacks occur in all of our employed physician practices, and right now we're pushing 80% calls to patients that go through our clinics where we own and operate those physician practices. And starting on January 1, we will do a similar callback program for all of our inpatients. Again, if you don't stay in touch with a customer, you can't be absolutely sure that you've met his or her needs. And then the last thing is how you do business. We have a very robust compliance program. We have a hotline that is accessible by physicians, employees, patients, or visitors. Every single call that comes to our corporate office, and fortunately the majority of them are HR related issues, but occasionally we're made aware of an issue, a concern, a problem of one of our properties that the traditional review mechanism for information flow has not been successful, and we are able to address those concerns. I get every day a copy of every single complaint call that comes into the corporate office that's related to a Division I hospital. And it's incumbent upon me and my staff and the local hospital teams to make sure that each one of those hotline calls are properly addressed. And we're quite proud of the record we have there. It's a voluntary program. It's not one that's been imposed on us. It's a voluntary program. With our partnership with the Studer Group, we've identified like five pillars, we call it. We have a safety and quality pillar, a service pillar, and a people pillar. And then we have a growth pillar and a finance pillar. And we believe that if we get safety and quality right, we treat our customers appropriately, we have great employee satisfaction, the result will be high growth and financial success. And when I was a much younger hospital executive, I probably found myself just chasing the financial success of the institution. As I aged and perhaps had a better appreciation for what happens in the world, it became crystal clear to me that if you deliver a quality patient care experience, those patients will come back to you and those patients by word of mouth will tell about their experience. And so if that is the reason that our company has put so much time and energy into the enhancing the clinical experience at CHS Hospital. To give you an idea of some of the diverse medical services we offer, we have this chart. I won't read each and every one of them, but you see we have a number of transplant centers, we have accredited chest pain centers, stroke centers, centers of excellence for bariatric services, et cetera. Across our system, we probably have now, it's 35 plus, I think it's about 40 Da Vinci robots that we employ in various hospitals around the CHS system. We also have been recognized by a large number of national agencies who attempt to measure quality and success in a hospital. You can see on this slide from Press Ganey to Reuters, the Joint Commission certifications, Modern Healthcare, Best Places to Work, a number of our facilities, and this is not all of them, but it's a sampling, large and small facilities have been successful as measured by outside agencies, not by CHS. This slide is our recent commitment to capital. You can see that the bar has consistently gone up and drooped down in 2009 a little bit, but our guidance this year is that we will spend between $800 and $850 million on capital investment. We probably have approximately 50 major projects underway at our facilities today. We've completed renovations in the emergency room in 13 ERs in the past 3 years. 55% of our admissions come through the ER, so we're critically tuned into the performance that our ERs render in each community we serve. In 2012, we had 3 replacement hospital projects, 2 have opened, 1's under construction. And over the past 2 years, almost 30% of our capital spend has been related to IT and electronic health records. And again, in 2012, we'll spend about $250 million on that IT initiative. This slide is 4 facilities that we have either completed a total replacements or major renovations just in the last year or two. And it gives you an idea of the perhaps the quality of work that we do in our construction department. We have internal experts for construction. We contract with third-party general contractors. We use local subs when we do a project like this. But we have an in-house oversight group that has been able to consistently deliver all of these major projects across our 29 states on time and within budget. And again, I think that's a score that would be hard to be matched by anyone. And obviously we understand in this particular market that the capital infusion going forward will be critical to this institution's success. There are different ways to approach the delivery of healthcare. And in our company, we tend to be standardized and centralized. That doesn't mean that you don't have local control, but what it means is when you go into a CHS hospital, you can expect the same level of care from the radiology department, whether you're in Bartow, California, Lake Wales, Florida, or Petersburg, Virginia. It's the same approach to delivering a service like a respected food chain might have, or a car manufacturer, anybody like that. We want the experience, the patient experience, the physician experience, and the employee experience to be the same across our system. So you have available to you 24/7 a cadre of people in Nashville that are both clinical champions and specialists in non-clinical areas that are made available to your facility every day throughout the year. There's no charge for that. These folks can help you in disaster situations. They can help you if you happen to have a sudden growth spurt that locally you have been unable to respond adequately to the volume. And in a myriad of ways, we can get resources to you to be ensure your success in both in the short term and the long term. We also opt for JCHO accreditation through a corporate process. There's a corporate team typically assigned to CHS from the Joint Commission. They come to Nashville and meet with us on the front end. We spend a day with them explaining how we do business. That team then goes out and surveys across our system of hospitals, probably 50 hospitals in any given year will have a Joint Commission accreditation. Last year, one of the surveyors remarked at the exit conference, and then at the end of the year, we have the same team come back to Nashville and talk to us about how they perceive we did as a system. And this is from Rex Smith, who is one of the Joint Commission survey team leaders. And the quote is, "You provide your hospitals with more tools than any other organization I see. You just do it." And again, this is an outside agency. This is not a hospital executive from CHS making that pronouncement. A little bit more about our commitment to quality. And this is where I talked to you about the patient safety high reliability initiative we started. We engage HPI out of Denver, Colorado. Carrie Johnson is the founder. As we sit here today, we have 10 CHS hospitals that are in comprehensive pilots to make sure that this new initiative will work. Once we are successful with these 10 pilots, we will roll it out then systematically in the other 125 hospitals in our system. Carrie was in Nashville a week ago Friday, and I met with him. We had the management teams in from our 10 hospitals that are in the pilots. And he said to me at the break at lunchtime, he said, "David, we've done high reliability initiatives with a number of organizations. We've never done one the size of CHS. And it astounds me to see the discipline that you have in your system and the execution that you bring to bear in the fact that everyone in this room, and there were probably 85 people in that room, has bought into the initiative." And I told him, I said, just like the Studer principles that we implemented 5.5 years ago, it starts with our CEO, Wayne Smith. He is absolutely committed to it. When you have a strong, powerful CEO that's that committed to an initiative, everybody else in the organization gets involved to the same degree. When we have our Studer group coaches come to Nashville and teach us for a day or two courses, Wayne Smith, our CEO, sits in that presentation all day, each day. David Miller sits in that presentation all day, each day. So we send a mighty powerful signal to all of our employees that these initiatives are critically important to our company. And again, those are the initiatives that will differentiate us from everybody else in the marketplace. The performance improvement, our clinical quality scores, I'm going to show you a slide on that. We have case management resources. We have RAC appeals unit in the corporate office. And we provide Joint Commission and regulatory support. We have a marvelous group in our quality and clinical transformation department. We do mock surveys with all of our hospitals before the survey time. If you have an unannounced state survey, we will attempt to get one of our quality people to your location to assist you with that survey process. Everybody knows 2 years ago, the Joint Commission began identifying top performing hospitals. This year, the Joint Commission identified 605 hospitals in the United States that they consider to be top performers. CHS, we have 135 hospitals. 50 of our hospitals were in that group of 605 in the United States. Again, I think a pretty impressive report card. We also, since 2007, have been trying to measure. It's a crude measure, but it's an overall satisfaction score and results score with core measures rolled into one raw number. Now, everybody in the room today understands that there are many more core measures than there historically have been. But the blue graph is our combined scores for 135 hospitals. And obviously, if you go back a couple of years, it wouldn't have been 135 hospitals. But that's our company score each year. And the red score is the score for the national average. So you can see that our system has consistently outperformed the national average with core measures results. That's this first slide here is for inpatients. Second slide is for outpatients. Again, the same type of result. At this point, I want to turn the program over to our chief medical officer, Dr. Barbara Paul. And believe it or not, she's actually been with us 6 years, and she's been a superstar for us and a contributing member. And I think one of the reasons why we are so connected to our physician partners. Dr. Paul.
Thank you, David, and thank all of you for taking time to meet with us today. I'm delighted to be here. This is my first time. And Ken and David said, I have been with the company for 6 years. I'm an internist. I grew up in Wisconsin, went to the University of Wisconsin at Madison, and then went west to medical school at Stanford, residency in San Francisco, and then I was in practice in internal medicine in Northern California for 12 years, full-time general internal medicine practice, young adults, elderly, hospice, inpatient, outpatient, the whole full-time practice. And then in 1999, my husband and I had opportunities. He had an opportunity to go work for a member of Congress in Washington, D.C., and I looked around and was able to create an opportunity to go work for Medicare. So we moved cross-country, and I was with then HCFA, now CMS, for 5 years. I reported to Clinton appointees for 2 years and Bush appointees for 2.5 years, and had a great experience during that time. Learned a lot of seat of my pants learning, learned a lot about medical politics and healthcare policy. Was able to lead a team that, as I think Ken talked about, our whole focus of that team was to find the red tape that was getting in the way of doctors as doctors were trying to take care of patients. And you could probably argue I should still be there because there's still a lot to work in that regard. But we did have some good success with that team. The last couple of years when I was at CMS, I led up a team or a department that helped to launch some of the quality initiatives that we're working through now. So I bring that experience now and to CHS. I'm glad to be here on this side of things, and it's a wonderful relationship that we have at the community health systems between people like David and our CEO, Wayne Smith, and the physicians around the company. My role at the company really is about physician relationships. I work to find ways to enhance educational opportunities for physicians, leadership development, and then just general relationship development. And I hope you'll see some of that as I talk about some of what I do. Before I move forward from this slide, though, I just want to also emphasize, as you look at this, and let me go back to inpatient for a second, the core measures results, this is a company average, 135 hospitals. Our company average is 98.4, 98.7%. Aggregating up all of the core measures, taking the average across the company. So we have a lot of people working very hard to do the right thing for patients, and it really shows when you aggregate things up like this. Same with the outpatient core measures, we're at 98.5% company-wide average. Really proud of a lot of people who work very hard. Let me tell you a little bit about some of the things that come out of my department. For me, it's not about my voice. It's about me finding ways to amplify the physicians' voices from around the company. As David said, we have 16,000 physicians on active and consulting medical staff. We actually have 37,000 physicians total when you include the courtesy and emeritus and et cetera. But so about 16,000 active physicians, and what I see as my role is to try to find ways to bring the actively practicing physician's voice into our work. So a number of things that we do. First of all, we have many of our hospitals do have chief medical officers or vice presidents of medical affairs. We have a monthly conference call with them. Very effective, very simple, very effective at allowing for an interchange of information, both from the corporate office, but also from them to us, as well as between each other. They also come together once a year when we bring in our chiefs of staff, another item that we do. This is an annual meeting where every chief of staff from around the company comes into Nashville. And it's a very busy 2.5 days of of pretty nitty-gritty curriculum. And as you know, who have been elected medical staff leaders, there's just a lot to know around credentialing and peer review and dealing with impairment and disruption and investigations and all the things that medical staff struggle to do as you are working to make sure that you're providing the highest quality care in your hospital. So this is a curriculum that we offer once a year face-to-face in Nashville. We know that face-to-face once a year is not enough, though, so we've also built out a website where we have created a whole series of modules, again, around the same topics to help our elected medical staff leaders. And we also have a quarterly newsletter, again, around the same topics, because we know that there's a lot of different ways that people like to learn, and there's just so much to take a look at. So we have all these different avenues, all focused on elected leaders and providing you with what you need to do your job. Physician advisory boards. I helped to convene physicians. Again, we usually come into Nashville. Part of the reason for that is our corporate team loves to talk to the docs and one-on-one and really hear what's going on. So we just concluded last week a two-day meeting with our cardiologists. We had about 20 cardiologists from around the company came in. Four of them gave presentations about their experiences and projects and growth in their communities and their challenges. One of them had done some research on where cardiology is going and what he sees as the future of cardiology. All of this was a really good discussion for the others in the room, but also more importantly from my standpoint, not probably from theirs, but I loved having these doctors at Nashville with our corporate team. We have nurses and subject matter experts and operations people who are all a part of that meeting and love just listening to the docs and finding out what's on their mind and making sure that the resources we're providing are the resources that they need to succeed. We did that for cardiac care just last week. We had an orthopedic meeting in June, and we'll have another one in February, very similar format where we seek physicians from around the company, and I'd love to invite your physicians to our next meeting. Zinc's order sets review. For the move toward computerized physician order entry, as you can imagine, with 135 hospitals, we have an enormous plan to help all 135 hospitals get to a place with computerized physician order entry and full, robust electronic health records. They're all at a little different stage, all working forward. One of the things that we know everyone is going to need are the evidence-based order sets that will be built into the computerized order entry systems. And so we have partnered with a company called Zinx Health. I don't know if you've heard of Zinx or are familiar with them, but they are a nationally recognized company that is very heavily physician and nurse led, and they have created these standardized order sets, which are predicated on the science. They are predicated on the literature that says this drug is better than this drug, and this treatment should be chosen before this treatment. And these order sets are created by Zinx, but they need to be refined before they can be built into computerized order entry. So we now have teams from around the company. We've got about 60, 70 doctors. They're meeting by conference call and webinar, and they're helping to take these order sets and rationalize them, tighten them down, make them good and sensible. And so this is a way that we're making sure that what then gets built into computerized physician order entry is well grounded in how physicians think. Now, just to assure you, these are order sets that are meant to kind of cover, 80% of the patients, 80% of the time. Physicians check the box or don't check the box. They always have the option of ordering something, not in the order set, but off the standard menu. These are just meant to be a time saver for physicians, but is a part of our approach to making sure that as we move toward CPOE, that we have a very high quality experience for our physicians and that we're providing best care for our patients. So my department's team is to help convene these doctors. That's my role, is the convening role. I just left this morning a day-long meeting that's going on in Nashville with all of our hospitalists. We have one hospitalist coming from each hospital in Nashville. They're there today, and they're getting together to share ideas and resources, hear from us, also hear from each other. And it's great because then they know who to call. They've got a few new colleagues who seem to be in similar situations who they can contact. They also know who at the corporate office they can contact for resources. Hospitalists are, I think, are a really important part of healthcare going forward. And I think there's a lot we can do to help to better support hospitalists in providing the highest quality care for our patients, as well as to support them in working across from the hospital to the outpatient setting as we're looking at things like reducing unnecessary readmissions and so forth. So a lot of work going on with our hospitalists, our emergency physicians, and particularly that transition of care. Physician partnerships and joint ventures. We have many facilities that are joint ventured. Obviously, with the Affordable Care Act, some of the rules changed on this. But we are certainly, as a company, very comfortable with creating win-win relationships that also have a financial component as well as a clinical and a professional component. One thing that I noticed in your materials that I was very delighted to see has to do with clinical integration. And I saw that you're engaging with Southwind and you're working toward a clinical integration project. To me, I think this makes a whole lot of sense. And we have some very early work on clinical integration as well. But I'm glad to see that you're doing it. And we could learn from you and we could learn together. But I think that model, for me as a physician, who loved being in independent practice, I think it's a way the docs who want to stay in independent practice can, and yet we can find a way to work together more closely and go in the same direction together. So very much appreciated reading a little bit about your endeavor in that regard. As David said, that we have about 2,600 employed physicians around the company. We have a team who's dedicated to helping to support those physicians, their practice managers, and the other personnel in those practices. And I get to get involved a little bit on the educational side and some coaching and some leadership development with them. We have a wonderful team who are working to support those employed physician practices and recruiting support as well. I actually have another slide on that, so I'll skip over that. As the slide says, I'm the chief medical officer. We also have a senior vice president chief quality officer. She and I each report to Wayne Smith, the CEO of the company. And to me, first of all, it suits our skill sets. She has a wonderful skill set in sort of day-to-day hospital quality, operational quality, getting it done on a day-to-day basis, Dr. Lynn Simon. So she's wonderful as a chief quality officer. What I like about the fact that she and I both report to Wayne is what it says about the company and its focus on quality. Wayne wants to know about quality directly. A lot of companies like us, the CMO, the chief quality officer reports to the CMO, and the CMO reports to the CEO. Here, both of us report to the CEO. It means that there's a very big focus on quality. We always meet on Mondays, as David will tell you, in the senior management meeting. And yes, we talk about some of the business aspects of what's going on, but just as much as time is spent on a lot of the quality related issues that are going on and challenges and successes that we're seeing around the company and some of the initiatives. We also, on the bottom, we have a physician informaticist. Actually, we have two of them now who are working in the company, again, trying to make sure that what we're doing as we move forward with electronic health records makes the most sense for physicians. This is a slide that talks about our physician satisfaction survey. We do an annual physician satisfaction survey. It is done for us by an outside vendor called HealthStream Research. They have about 600 hospitals around the company who are their clients. And we ask, 40, 50 questions of our doctors every year about how things are going with the nursing care, with the administrative responsiveness, with the efficiency of their day, with the quality of care in the hospital, et cetera. And I get to do a lot of cheerleading and showing the spotlight. Our hospital CEOs and administrative teams do a lot of work around this. This is a slide that I'm really delighted to show, which shows the overall satisfied, for, in this case, this year, 7,700 physicians around the company with over, about a 55% response rate this year. 36% of our physicians said that they were overall very satisfied. To me, I mean, physicians are tough customers. We don't say we're very satisfied very easily. And for us as a company, I joined the company back in 2007. Actually 2006 informally, but more formally in 2007. You can see that from 2008 to 2012, we've gone from 25% very satisfied to 36% very satisfied. That's a lot more doctors who are, you know, if they're willing to say they're very satisfied, that's a measure of loyalty, of engagement, that maybe that we're doing the right thing and being very responsive to them, and that our administrative teams are really focusing. Our administrative teams take this information, they dig through it, they have a deep dive phone call with our vendor to dig into it and try to look behind these numbers, and they are all accountable for an action plan at their hospital, and I think that's why this has moved forward, and their accountability is to their operational leadership, like David. Physician recruitment, we know that that this can be very challenging in some communities. So what we have is a dedicated team back at the corporate office who can do a lot of the legwork. You still create your own physician recruitment plan. You still decide whether or not they're going to go into an independent practice with an income guarantee or they're going to become employed. That's all a local decision. But what our team will do is help to source candidates for you. And they have an enormous database of physicians and are able to find physicians who might have a little itch that they need to scratch and might be interested in coming and talking to you about opportunities here. They get out to residencies and do programs at residencies, to job fairs, you name it, they are out there trying to find the docs who then you can talk to and decide whether they're a right match for your community. David opened with really the mission of our company, which is creating great places for people to work, physicians to practice medicine, and patients to receive care. And I love that mission because it acknowledges that you can't just do one and you can't have one trump the others. They're all three important. So it's nice for me to be able to tell you about a couple other aspects. First of all, employee satisfaction. We survey our employees annually. And we have, as David said, about 90,000 employees. We had about 70,000 of them respond to the survey, and this tends to be pretty consistent. And here's what they had to say, that 85% are satisfied as a place to work. 89% proud to be part of their respective organization, 89% satisfied with the courtesy and respect they receive from coworkers, et cetera. I saw your results. You have some very nice results. I think that we could help you just take this to the next level in terms of understanding what's behind some of the questions and then how to take your employee satisfaction to the next level. This initiative that we call Community Cares, in which we're partnering with the Studer Group, teaches managers, administrators, physicians, nurses, others, a whole variety of tools and techniques, but also just a philosophy of communication and service that we are seeing directly translated into our employee satisfaction survey results. And so those are some of the things that we would like to bring to working with you. Our patient satisfaction results continue to improve and are another area of focus and another area where our Community Cares initiative again brings a focus and tools. As you can see, the national average is down the right-hand column for these components of the patient satisfaction survey. You can see Mr. Miller's division here, which is doing very well. We all, again, I looked at yours, I can see that you're improving, that you have some challenges in that regard, but you're improving. I think we could help and work with you as we all work together to try and improve how our patients experience communication from their nurses, how our patients' pain is managed, et cetera. As many of you know, The results from this survey are being used in the value-based purchasing payment model that went into effect 2 days ago. And so not only are these things the right thing to do, which they always have been, but there's now actually a payment, either penalty or incentive from the federal government if we can get this right. So we have some tools that we think are working very well and helping our hospitals, and we would love to work with you to help you.
You know, excuse me, we're giving 45 minutes. I think we're there already.
Good.
We can give you a few more minutes, five more minutes. I don't know who else is going to be speaking. Anyone?
It's just back to David for a few minutes.
Trying to rush you, but we have a schedule, so another five more minutes. And
very good.
And we apologize.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your time and look forward to the questions.
Thank you. One point that I want to mention about the value-based purchasing that Dr. Paul just referred to, which went into effect October 1st. I told you at the beginning of my comments that there are 25 hospitals in Division I. This year, 23 out of the 25 hospitals in Division I will be net gainers under the value-based purchasing arrangement. Again, I think another indicator that demonstrates our commitment to quality. Very quickly, the local governing boards of each of our hospitals, 100% area residents, there are no corporate representatives on the board, includes medical staff representation. The boards assist us with strategic plan development, meeting the needs of the community, development of the operating capital budgets, reviews of the CEOs, grants medical staff privileges, ensures quality indicators are there, Joint Commission accreditation is attained, supports physician recruiting, and is a link to the community in terms of our relationship. The one thing that would be different, this board that you have today versus the CHS board, is you do not have fiduciary responsibilities. That corporation assumes that. Quickly, we think that Monroe would remain the preferred healthcare system in the region. There's a number of initiatives that we would pursue to ensure that that happens. Your team shared with us some of the service lines that they hope that would be expanded going forward. You can see these and read these on your own. Our proposal, the summary real quickly, $155 million for the lease, upfront payment, 40 years with the option to renew. You all retain the control of the land, buildings, and furniture at the end of the lease. The 5 years before the lease was to expire, every capital expenditure that we made, we would get approval from ahead of time, since should we choose to walk away, you would be responsible for reimbursing us for the capital we spent in that last 5 years. That, again, in my mind, is a way to ensure that throughout the entire 40 years, the hospital is run in an appropriate manner, and no one is shortchanged, specifically the community. The master facility plan, you'll see that our commitment's a little bit different. You had asked for a commitment for a firm $150 million, do it just like you guys have said it. Our commitment is that we understand that there's a major facility need here. We commit to doing a master plan, but we were going to have our folks look at the plan and put our budgeting process in place, our pricing in place, to see just how much those enhancements might be. The commitment to routine, a minimum of $10 million per year for the first 5 years going forward. Board composition, you can see that, 9 to 12 members, 100% local, 3 to 5 members of the medical staff. And the district would have one representative for the first 5 years. Commitment to maintain the services that are in place for 5 years. And if we were to choose to change, eliminate, modify, we would get the local board's approval. We would accept the local community's existing charity care program. And we would agree to employ all employees who are today in good standing at the time the transaction were to close. We think that you benefit by our CHS relationship, by our unwavering support to continue leading in patient safety and quality. The resource we provide to you in terms of operation and support, our robust physician recruiting plan, 100% local board, the tax revenues that we begin to generate for your community, and a partner who lives up to and exceeds its promises. Thank you.
If Thank you for the information. It was very, very interesting. We'll go ahead and open it up to you. Some questions and answers from the option committee and or anybody else from the management team that will be here. After that, we'll have 10, 15 minutes of the community's questions and answers. So we'll start over here. Anyone with any questions?
Hi, my question's for Dr. Paul. You mentioned that you had a couple of related questions with relation to the medical staff. I am the, as of 2 days ago, the immediate past president of the medical staff. You had said that you had a meeting in Nashville with all the hospitalist groups. Do you have one hospitalist group in each hospital? Is it one hospitalist group for the entire system? Do you employ the hospitalists? What's your structure?
Each hospital is a little different. There's certainly not one hospitalist group across the system. So it's locally decided. Sometimes it is a local group that's employed. Sometimes it's a local group that's contracted. We do have a number of hospitals who we contract through a company called Apogee for a number of our hospitals. A couple of other national organizations, Schumacher, a couple others. It's very much locally driven based on what the need is and what the desire is of local medical staff and local hospital.
So do you have hospitals with more than one hospitalist group within a single hospital?
We do, not very many, but we do. It often will be that if there's a large multi-specialty group, they may want their own hospitalists to take care of their own patients, and then there may be another hospitalist group that takes care of the patients who are not a part of that group, something like that. But again, it's based on the local situation.
And my other half of the question is sort of the flip side. You had mentioned about the order sets and the computer data entry. I go to four different hospitals. To have to do this hospital-specific, idiosyncratic thing at each and every hospital, when I first came, I did my training in New York, where the population density is such that it's impossible for a physician to be on staff at all the hospitals in their geographic area. And a patient would typically ask, which hospital does a certain doctor go to? Mm-hmm. When I came here to Ocala, patients would ask me, well, which hospital do you go to? And I said, well, both. It's just right across the street. And there was a lot of cooperation. When I came, both hospitals gave me the same dictation number, so I could remember the same number. Both, there was a lot of understanding that the medical staff is fluid between them. Mm-hmm. I get the sense that got to be the CHS way in all your systems. There's a lot of uniformity. How much of that my perception is true, and how much is there just really availability at the local level to make things different?
Well, fundamentally, we are about using sort of standardization at times, but to use it to create a more efficient experience for physicians and higher quality care. So if it's not doing that, we're going to take a look at it, first of all. But on CPOE, we are building the CPOE onto the existing hospital's infrastructure. So you have McKesson here. So we have a number of McKesson hospitals. We're using the Zinc's order sets, and they're going to be built into the McKesson system. Other of our hospitals are Meditech or HMS or other. The Zinc's order sets will get built into those systems. There, because it's electronic health records, there is a limited ability to customize the order set itself. But as I said, the physicians always have the opportunity to go outside the order set. Does that help answer your question?
I guess to the extent that you can.
Yeah, I think the other point to make, which I know you know, which is on in health IT, I think we're a number of years away from what you and I would really like, which is one system wherever we practice, wherever our patients are, that we can get in and find the information we need, just as we do with banking and other things. And I think health IT is moving in that direction. You know, the health information exchanges are going to help in that, but the products aren't there yet. They still have these proprietary features of them So once they start to break those down, I think we will get to a place where we have a little more seamless inpatient, outpatient, nursing home, hospital A, hospital B, but right now these products are part of what are getting in the way.
Let me try and address it too on specific to the zinc sorter sets. As Dr. Paul said, and you know, the zinc sorter sets are evidence-based, so that there's some credibility there. Then the second step, we created user committees of physicians by physician specialty to take a look at the sets. Then the third review is at the local level, and we have empowered each CEO to pay one or more physicians on the medical staff to further refine the zinc sorter sets so that they are specific to the conditions in the local market. So it's not a one Nashville brand that gets rammed down 135 locations.
You indicated how you and Mr. Smith have meetings with your teams, and that indicates the importance to those teams that, you know, to CHS, of those matters that you're talking about. Where's Mr. Smith today? Why isn't he here with us?
Well, Mr. Smith, as I told you in my remarks, when we have big events in the corporate office, he is at the hospitalist meeting, which was scheduled many, many months ago, and he will sit with those 80 or 90 physicians that are across our system in Nashville today to participate in that session.
I want to thank you for your interest in our community, our hospital, and all the time you spent on this proposal. If money were no object, we probably wouldn't be here, because I may be prejudiced, but I'll stack our hospital against the best in your system. But of course, money is an object, and that's why we're entertaining this. And we've got to make a tough choice or recommendation to the decision maker. We got three suitors, as you know, and it's our job to try to peer into the future beyond the time the ink is dry and determine what it's going to be like to the physicians that practice here, the employees that work here, the patients and their families that interact with the hospital. And that's a decision that's probably irrevocable, practically speaking, 40-year lease, 20-year option. I would suspect that everybody in this room would be dead by the time that's So that we're not cursed from the grave by our children. I don't want to be melodramatic, but that's a fact, Paul Clark. You know, and we won't be in Kansas anymore, Toto, because
barely be 100 then.
If I have a problem with this hospital, I call one of these three guys now, and that's not going to be the way it is with any of the three. So tell me why you, as opposed to HMA or Duke Life Point.
First of all, I think all three companies are good companies. So whichever, should you choose one, I think you'll be fine with any of the three suitors that you have. What you have with CHS, I believe, is a stable, experienced, long-tenured senior management. You can look at the senior management teams for the three organizations, and you'll see there's a bit of a difference there. I think second and probably most important is the fact that we see the changing world, the need for partnerships between physicians, the emphasis on clinical outcomes, and the idea that our world is changing and changing dramatically over the next 10 to 15 years. And you have to be transparent about what you do, and you better be able to flip a chart up on the board that shows outstanding clinical outcomes, or you do run the risk of being excluded from a payer mix. We believe that 15 years from now, 10 years from now, if you don't have superior outcomes, it won't just be Humana, Aetna, Cigna, Blue Cross that might exclude you from the network. You could get excluded from the Medicaid or Medicare program, TRICARE program. If that occurs, you won't be able to keep your doors open. So I think our commitment to quality is demonstrated our 5.5-year relationship with the Studer Group and our 1-year plus relationship with the high reliability group out of Denver, Colorado, will separate us from the rest of the conglomerates like ours in this industry.
Maybe I could also add that I appreciate that for you, this is the only time you're going to make this decision, and it's a big decision for us that we tend to acquire 3, 4, 5 hospitals a year. So our team, particularly people like Ken, are very experienced in that. So I really appreciate that this is a big decision for you. And I've been with the company now 6 years, and I've been through this a number of times with medical staffs. And I would encourage you to call your colleagues, particularly I'm talking to the doctors in the room, to call your colleagues from around the country who might be at another CHS-affiliated hospital and ask them how it's going. Also to, as a board, to consider going and visiting one or more of our hospitals and seeing what it's like, and or coming to the corporate office to meet some of the people who both of us are referencing. I think you'll find that there's a genuine commitment to quality. And I think you'll also find that if you do have a problem, there is one person at the hospital you can call. The leadership at that hospital still feels very strongly about the quality of care and the experience for patients at that hospital, and very strongly for the community. I think that we would benefit from affiliating with you. You do have some wonderful things going on here in terms of quality and efficiency, and I think we would benefit from affiliating with you. I also think that you would benefit from affiliating with us, speaking through my lens, from the standpoint of the resources we can bring you on the quality and clinical side. And we've got to leverage those resources going forward so that not every hospital has to build a new department for all these things that keep coming down the pike, but we can build it once sometimes at the corporate office and then leverage it across multiple hospitals. And that's going to be one of the benefits that we're going to be able to bring to independent hospitals like yours. And so I think that will be something that you could look forward to, and I hope I explained a few examples of in my talk.
I would think too that since we have two other properties in Florida, in Lake Wales and Crestview, that phone calls there, whether it be to, if you call Lake Wales, you can call Jim Nelson, who's the past president of the medical staff there. Jim is from that area. You can call Mr. Hunt, the head of Florida Natural, in the Growers Co-op there. They are delighted with the relationship that they have with us. You can go to Crestview, you talk to Lee Thigpen, who's a hometown physician who's been there, you talk to the mayor. We've been there for about 15 years, and I think that's the way you can find out what type of partner we might be.
All right, anybody else?
Mike had a question.
Go ahead. Well, just one follow-up, and I don't mean to embarrass you all by this question, although as a lawyer, I've enjoyed embarrassing witnesses before. About the status of the investigation your company by the, what is it, Department of Health and Human Services?
Obviously, it's an ongoing investigation, so we're very limited what we can say, but the OIG is looking at some of our facilities in the country. That review came by our failed attempt to acquire the Tenet organization in Dallas, Texas. Tenet made some rather wild accusations about our company. And as part of that, they copied their accusations to the federal government. And the federal government has taken a look at that. Now, the scope of the review has been narrowed significantly from when it initially started. I would also tell you that a federal district judge in Dallas threw out the Tenet lawsuit last March and threw it out with prejudice. And that was a great win for our company, which substantiated, I think, the position that we do not have a problem, but it's an ongoing process. You would also know that simultaneous to this, I won't list the companies, but there are probably 6 or 7 other for-profit companies that are undergoing similar reviews right now, and 3 or 4 major not-for-profit chains that are going through a similar review as we sit here today. What that is all about is the cost of healthcare in this country is now about 16% of gross national product, and the folks are looking at that for waste, abuse, and whatever. We're not trying to be cocky, but we have done exhaustive reviews of what our system has done, and we see no systematic problems. Now, with 90,000 employees and 16,000 physicians, is there the possibility there's a maverick or two out there that may have done something that's inappropriate? That's probably, that could have occurred.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
If I could follow up on something Mr. Klein sort of started with. Mr. Miller, you said all the hospitals have the same operational problems, but I would contend that the magnitude of those problems varies. And I think our biggest issue that Randy, in a sense, referred to is our payer mix. And as I guess you know, you've probably looked at our numbers. Moody's indicates that we're right at the top of poor payer mixes. And my concern is, what are you going to do differently that's going to improve our bottom line? Because I don't see that economies of scale or even better contracts are going to be sufficient. And the amount of money you're directing towards us, the $10 million in capital, we put $20 million away in terms of trying to maintain our hospital. So unless one of your other hospitals is going to give us some money from their bottom line, I continue to be concerned that the only thing that can suffer is quality, because if we don't have the money to do the job, we're going to have to change nursing ratios, buy less expensive equipment, even if it's not as good. You know, all those kind of things you would do if you're short of cash. So could you clarify a little better how you can ensure that we can maintain quality and that we will have as Dr. Cleverly from Ohio State came here and said, we need to be making 6% on our money every year to sustain ourselves. We need a lot of help to get to that point.
To your first comment or about problems that every hospital is facing, what I'm talking about there is the pressures on reimbursement and then the pressure on costs escalating. So, and I don't care where you are, I think every hospital in this country has to deal with that. Now, I've done a number of these acquisitions before, and your board is not too dissimilar to any other board. Say, well, we think we're managed as tightly as we can. We think we have the best pricing that we can get. Well, we're part of a GPO, group purchasing organization, that has a buy of $18 billion per year, and we're an equity partner there. Our pricing is as good as anybody in the country. Not only do we get best pricing, because we're an equity partner, we get a return on the purchases that the non-equity people get. So our supply expense, I suspect, would be different than what yours is. I've not been inside your walls other than for a half a day. I don't know how good you respond to peaks and troughs in staffing, but we do a pretty good job there. I'll give you, for instance, in Division I, 25 hospitals in the southeastern part of the United States, I have 16,000 full-time employees. Last pay period, I had 5.5 contract nurses in 25 hospitals in 7 states with 16,000 employees. My guess is you probably have a few more contract labor employees here than that.
Well, I'd leave it to the administration, but we've had periods recently without any at all, and I think I hear you, but I thought you were asking for an answer for me, but go ahead.
No, my point is, I think our proven approach to staffing models and things like that have been successful for us, and I think we would probably refine. We think you have a good hospital here, but we think there's an opportunity to refine it here, too.
So you feel like you could save us $20 to $30 million on expenses a year at this point in time, because basically we're sort of even. We're not really making that 6% profit. Based on our revenue, 6% would put us at about $18 million a year, and we need a little fudge in there. So you could probably $25 million.
Between better revenue cycle management and better expense management, I suspect that would be the case. Yes, sir.
We can't count on any money from anybody else. I mean, basically, we have to make it here.
Oh, no, in a given year, look, our corporation doesn't pay dividends. So all the money that we make as a company gets reinvested in our properties. Because you have 135 properties, some properties perform well in a given year, some don't. those that aren't performing well in a given year, they're the beneficiaries of being a part of a system as big as ours that we can help carry them. And so is there, I wouldn't take money from Lake Wales per se and put it in Ocala, but the system will make sure that cash is available to this institution to do the things that need to be done.
So this transaction is also with the hospital district, which is the entire county of Marion County, which is geography the size of Rhode Island, about 330,000 people. And so it's more than just the hospital, and healthcare is local. So our demographic is also old, 27% are over 65, and very sick, sicker than the average. The hospital has actually performed pretty well. Our scores for taking care of patients is very good, but our community standard of health is still very low because of economics and because of bad choices. And those bad choices then are borne upon the hospital to improve outcomes for the patients in this community. You mentioned that you're working on clinical integration. I actually think that's really our only hope to survive the future, is actually to improve care in the community that's not necessarily occurring in the hospital. And that the 5-year, 10-year plan may be multiple points of presence and not just a hospital system in our community. Can you speak to your plans for clinical integration? Are you looking at ACOs? Are you looking at clinical integration? Are you looking at further employment of physicians or more partnerships with physicians? What do you see as the ultimate nirvana for our community?
I'm not sure that today there is one model that would fit all. We have in markets like Florence, South Carolina, Vicksburg, Mississippi, Huntsville, Alabama, we have large groups of employed physicians. And in those markets, we're able to jointly approach the healthcare delivery issues. In our employed clinics, we have this past year implemented a new wellness initiative to get at part of the problems that you are addressing. And the irony of all that is that the Medicare program, for sure, has great reimbursement and encourages the Medicare patient to participate in these wellness initiatives, new to Medicare initiatives. So we're doing that with our employed physicians. We offer those same types of programs to the independent practitioners in our communities, but we don't have the ability to implement that concept in their practice, obviously. You can't syndicate in hospital anymore, but I have about 7 hospitals, both Lake Wales and Crestview are syndicated facilities. The physicians have a minority ownership in those facilities. And again, they're, generally speaking, lockstep in with us and what we want to do when we go to talk to Blue Cross Blue Shield or Aetna, Humana, whomever it is. So I don't think today I could sit here and say this is the one model that will work for the next 10 years. And candidly, I think the outcome of the election, the first week of November, will have a whole lot to do as to whether or not the current program, the Affordable Care Act, it stays intact as it is or it's changed. I was at a meeting in Birmingham last night where Carl Rove and James Carville were the two featured speakers, and that was quite an event. But their view of the world is a little bit different, as you can well imagine, but they had no shortcut. This is what's going to happen after the election. So I think that's going to be a huge indicator. Everybody got excited for a little bit when the Supreme Court ruled this summer that the law was constitutional, but if it's not funded, it won't be put in place. So we're just not an organization that's going to be way out front and then find out that we're wrong. We're going to see how everything really lines up and then get aggressive about what processes we implement to be successful in that environment.
If I could make a couple comments on that, I think that when I talk to doctors around the country, I've been struck in the last several years versus 10 years ago, certainly, that physicians, I'm finding, like the idea of working together with a company that's strong and stable and kind of methodical and thinks things through and is going to be able to weather this uncertainty in this time of incredible change together. As David said, we don't know exactly what the model's going to look like in the next few years, but I think we as a company have enough infrastructure stability that we're going to be able to figure it out together with the physicians in our communities. We have, you know, in addition to, we have employed physicians, we have joint ventured physicians. We are beginning to look at clinical integration and have some places where they have sort of a beginning version of that. We have one market where they do have their own insurance product in Indiana. And I think we're going, you know, people are going to have to look at insurance products as this goes forward. We also, as a company, have about 70 home health agencies and hospices around the country, each of them affiliated with a local hospital. It starts to create an infrastructure that you don't quite know what it's going to look like down the road, but you're starting to have the pieces. And if you've got the relationships, then you're going to figure it out together. And I feel much more confident working with a company like this to figure it out than just kind of trying to go it alone. I struggle with how that is going to work out for folks.
Yeah, one of the big issues I guess we need to address is obviously if the hospital has more income, it makes all the finances better. There's a significant number of patients who feel that they need to leave the community to receive either perceived better care or services that aren't available, or, you know, for a variety of reasons. How would being part of the CHS system help us capture that out-migration, either from a business or a quality or a service line point of view?
We have a corporate marketing and strategic planning department. Each division has at least one executive assigned to it. Ours is Scott Johnson, who helped the local operators develop their strategic plans. And most recently, I've had Scott go into four of our markets and spend 2 or 3 days. He in effect becomes a secret shopper, and he goes into the HCA facility across the street or wherever and tries to identify strengths and weaknesses of your competition. And then we try and come back and work with the incumbent management team to help them specifically design a plan that's unique to their hospital that capitalizes on your strengths and promote those to the community. One of the things we think that your greater community offers is opportunity for us to get into the secondary markets and have those patients come here that maybe heretofore have been going elsewhere. But without that resource readily available to you, it's hard to do that. And then we also contract with some outside marketing firms to assist us and further refine our initiatives. In Birmingham, Alabama, we have a very difficult fight to as the CON state to replace one of our 550-bed hospital there. We want to put $300 million into the digital health hospital that's sitting idle on the side of the road that HealthSouth started about eight years ago. We have engaged all sorts of outside expertise in Birmingham to ensure our success when we finally get the CON there. And that is the type of resource we would make available to your team here to help you with that issue.
Also, you know, what your question speaks to kind of exactly the sweet spot of this company. This company is focused on growth and on finding where it is in the community where there are people who are either driving around the hospital because of perceived issues or because there is a lack of services or specialties, and finding strategic planning, finding ways to build those services and bring those patients in. And in addition, it's about demonstrating quality, though. It's not just about growing service lines anymore. It's also about demonstrating the quality of that care and having the infrastructure to share with the community how what your quality is like. And again, I know you have some of that infrastructure, and a fair bit, but we also bring some of that infrastructure so you can be sharing with the community how you're doing with the quality. So that the growing of service lines is very strategic. Recruitment plans that are very strategic, and then bringing people back into the community. In addition, another way to succeed financially is to find ways to be able to take care of sicker and sicker patients by improving, again, the expertise of nurses and others at your hospital, the physicians at your hospital, and by taking care of sicker patients. You're going to avail yourself of.
Thank you. By getting the expertise into your hospital to be able to take care of sicker patients, you're also going to be able to avail yourself of a better payer mix.
Just a follow-up comment. As a physician who's been practicing in the area for 17 years, I feel a three-way magnet pulling at us from three different directions. We have a state-funded, tax-sponsored facility to our north called the University of Florida. To our southwest is the Moffitt Cancer Center, the only freestanding cancer center, which is also state-funded and tax-supported. And soon to be in the southeast, the University of Central Florida College of Medicine, to be sucking patients away. So it's a formidable task, one we struggle with every day.
I would just say that you would have some colleagues around this company who are struggling with different but similar competitive environments. It's what people in this company know how to do, and people know that you've got to, again, be demonstrating quality in order to compete in that way. Also, to have a very high quality service experience for patients and their families, and that will also be a part of what can attract patients here.
Oh, in Birmingham, Alabama, we have Trinity Medical Center. Probably 2 miles away, we have the University of Alabama Medical Center, twice our size. Our cardiovascular program is the number one rated program in the state of Alabama. So we have no problem competing with those fine teaching institutions. In Petersburg, Virginia, which is about 20 miles from downtown Richmond, Virginia, you have the Medical College of Virginia. Since we relocated our hospital to Interstate 95 and built a total replacement, we have astounded the population with growth there. We have probably averaged 8% a year growth the last 3 years since we've been there, despite having three or four large HCA hospitals in the community, in the Medical College of Virginia, and a large successful Catholic hospital. So competition, I think, just makes all of us sharper.
In your last slide, Mr. Miller, you said, and it's not up there, but you said that all the employees would be hired. I assume they'd become at-will employees in your company.
Yes, sir, that's right.
Yeah, so they could be, you know, like any employee, terminated without
yes.
cause.
Yes, sir.
And then the other thing you said is you would retain OB, pediatrics, and I think it was diabetes, unless the board. It couldn't be terminated without the local board approval?
We committed to keep all services for the first 5 years of the relationship.
Okay.
After 5 years, we would then deal with the local board and then get their concurrence before we were to eliminate service.
The local board would have a veto power over the big board in Tennessee?
Ultimately, no, but I mean, you're not going to be successful if we sit here and the local board says, no, don't do something, and we go ahead and do it. I mean, that doesn't make for a good partnership. That every time, and it's only been a few times that we have eliminated a service, and the local board might have been disappointed, but they're not. They saw the wisdom of our decision.
Have you ever eliminated OB in any of your hospitals?
Yes, sir. I have two small hospitals that where the number of deliveries got down to like 20 a month or something like that, and we only had one practitioner. And yes, sir, we did close those services.
I'll just add to the You don't foresee that here, of course?
No, sir, not with the volume that you have here.
Mike?
Near the end, you talked and said you would guarantee $10 million in routine capital for 5 years. Correct in that regard?
Yes, sir.
The fact that the hospital has been spending about $20 million the last several years and anticipates continuing to do that, we already got at loggerheads in a sense over that issue. I mean, how you want to up your offer to meet what we're doing now?
Well, I guess we're always flexible. I mean, we can lower the initial offering price and then offer increase that and back.
I didn't ask for that. No, I mean, in a sense, I'm being serious. I mean, right from the beginning, we and Dr. Cleverly again from Ohio State felt like we needed to put more money into capital. We're not buying icing for the cake. We're trying to just do what is necessary to provide quality, again, back to quality, that we feel like every purchase is carefully scrutinized, and yet that's what it's taking to make the hospital function at the level that the board's happy with.
Well, again, our commitment was a minimum of $10 million a year. Didn't say that we couldn't do more than that, but again, look, when you do a huge transaction like this, the business enterprise has a value. You can pay more on the front end and commit less on capital on the back end. But the total amount, I think you're going to find from the various suitors, is going to be very similar. We're perfectly willing to, at the appropriate time with the appropriate people, reconfigure our offer if that's what it takes. But I would rather underpromise and overdeliver to you than reverse. I don't know. There's so many changes coming in this world. I don't want to sit here and tell you I can spend $15 million a year for the next 5 years and $150 million in capital, because there's too much at risk out there, and I'm not willing to make that kind of commitment with the unknowns that are out there.
Joe, you have a question?
Have you ever sold a hospital that you acquired?
Yes, sir. We've sold two or three small hospitals in communities that were really struggling and just didn't fit. But I'd say in the 15 years I've been with CHS, by the ones we've probably sold about three. When we did the Triad acquisition in July 25th, 2007, we picked up 53 hospitals. We had at the time about 60-some. We did at that point in time sell I believe it was 10 or 11 hospitals. They were primarily very small hospitals, and we sold those to a startup company also in Nashville, Tennessee.
And what do you envision the role or how you would integrate Monroe in your system?
Well, because of the size and complexity of your institution here, we would like to make it a focal point for this part of the state of Florida, and we would very aggressively do an outreach program, primarily in the outpatient areas, in the secondary markets, as I referenced, to try and enhance the number of volume of folks that come through your institution here. And I think the numbers I recall, you have about a 62% market share. I think the other guys have maybe 38%, and probably you're losing a little bit. We try to work real hard to capture some of the out-migration and then enhance the volumes here through the secondary market that where people are going elsewhere other than to your system here.
To that sense, there's one error in your first slide that recruits physicians' care and then emergency room visits. That's counterintuitive that the emergency room would still be your front door. I would rather see outpatient community endeavors that direct patients to the hospital for appropriate care, but not through emergency room care.
I guess the point I was trying to make is, in the system that we have today, with the reimbursement mechanisms in place and the lack of coverage, until the entire system is changed, one has to pay attention to the emergency room if 55% of your patients come through there. And I don't think your facilities, much different than our facilities. I'm just suggesting that when that big a book of your business comes that way, you have to pay attention to that. I'm not saying you try and
grow that any, but you have to pay attention to it.
No, I agree.
Yeah, and I agree that the way forward is to for a given community to build their physician base of primary care and to find ways to shore that up and help patients people to have the care in those offices. The patient-centered medical home is a great model. We have a number of physicians who use that model. But doing things that shore up and enhance primary care in communities is going to be the way forward as well.
And the other thing is we've learned that, you know, for many patients, their, you know, some of their first experiences with a hospital or a health system is in the ER. And, you know, if they don't have a good experience there, if they're left waiting for hours in the waiting room, the next time they need care, they'll drive to Gainesville or, you know, Tampa or wherever. So, I mean, that's the lesson that we have learned over the years is you got to provide a first-rate patient experience for these guys if you want them to continue to use your service.
Any other questions? See if...
I guess I have two questions. One question, one follow-up question to that. And my comments are going to be, you know, perceived to sort of be talking about what we do here a little bit, but it's not meant to be any kind of platitudes for us, but just to help the board sort of answer some fundamental questions that they're trying to get through with the evaluation that we're going through. And, you know, this process really started about 6 years ago when we started our strategic planning process, and I was asked to take a look at it, and we did that, and there was absolutely no question, both from management standpoint and from board standpoint, that we were going to have to do something to shore up our financial performance, our operating performance, and our market performance. Not because we were you know, shy in terms of our or holding back any in terms of our performance and quality. I think that's been recognized. You've got leading cardiovascular programs. We have arguably the best cardiovascular program in the state of Florida, and ranked, you know, annually and amongst the best. I mean, so we've got some very good, solid, you know, clinical programs here. And our clinical outcomes, I mean, admittedly, I think we have some opportunities in the core measures. We're improving rapidly there. But again, we've not focused on that top performer list with Joint Commission because, frankly, our view has been you're focusing on your clinical outcomes and you're either accredited or you're not. And I had Ann Scott Bluen, you know, at our VHA meeting last week and basically expressed concern amongst a bunch of other CEOs as to why they started that process, because you've got health grades and care checks and everybody in the world now in the ratings game, and it's really confusing the public. So we decided, you know, to focus on those things that patients really care about, and that is, you know, do they come out of the hospital without complications, without infections? Are they safe? What are the mortality rates, et cetera? So the quality side of things, you know, we've always done a great job with that. And we got to looking at, you know, what our capital needs were going to be, what are our financial requirements in order to, you know, maintain, which is the key point here, is access to capital. We've got a strong strategic, you know, plan that's built around four, you know, strategic imperatives, which we shared with you during our management presentation, including we just established our organizational structure for clinical integration. And now, we've heard more than one presentation that mentioned that, so that gives me some certain comfort that we're sort of on the right track there. But we got to looking at the reality of the situation after having been analyzed by Dr. Cleverly and a bunch of other folks that basically concluded that, well, you know, you don't have a problem on the cost side, and, you know, we track that, you know, very, very closely. Our salaries, wages, and benefits as a percentage of net revenue is less than 42. It's been from 40, ranged from 40 to about a little over 41. That's probably in the range that the, you know, best performing investor-owned hospital systems are operating in. HCA last year was somewhere around 40. You know, I heard you mentioned, you know, on your supply side, I think we have opportunities in supply chain. You mentioned $18 billion worth of spend company-wide, and you know,
the whole group,
$18 billion. We belong to a group purchasing organization. I don't know how familiar our board is, but you know, we belong to VHA, we're Novation, and you know, we've got about $40 billion of annual spend in there, and we get pretty good pricing. I think we still have some work to do in really honing in our physician preference items and some things like that, but we're working on it. But when you looked at that and you looked at our total cost per adjusted discharge, you know, we're around 4,800. We're well below 5,000 per adjusted discharge, which puts us in the best quartile. We're the second best in our peer group in the state. And so as we began looking at, okay, what are our options here? We began to understand, okay, on the revenue side, okay, that's where we really need to focus on. And I believe we do have some pricing opportunities because we're not part of a large network. We can't leverage you know, the power of a large network with the third party payers. And so, you know, we probably have a little bit better job to do, but I think we could take that to the next level with our clinical integration, and in addition to becoming a part of a larger integrated network. And that's something I think that maybe our board, you know, would like to hear you address a bit. And so, the key question that needs to be answered here is, as we move forward this process, how, because once you do this, the toothpaste is out of the tube. And whoever comes in here, if we decide to go that way, is going to need to be successful. I mean, really successful. And the communities get behind it. Everybody, the physicians need to get behind it. Everybody, because if it's not successful, then we're going to be right back in a really bad situation. It's going to be hard to put that toothpaste back, you know, back in the tube. And so the key question is, how are you going to be able to demonstrate, you know, if you're running 36, you know, percent on salaries, wages, and benefits as a percent of net revenue, you said, well, you say, okay, you're going to go from 40 to 36, and here's how we're going to do it. Here's the supply cost, and we think you can be here, and that's the way you're going to do it. You know, you've got your total cost looks like it's a little bit out of whack. Okay, here's how we're going to do it. And let's take a look at your strategy. Here's your four strategic imperatives, and this is what we would do different because we think this would increase your market share, which we have had some challenges in over the last several years. All to end up to a number that says, okay, this is how we think we can protect quality, make a reasonable return for our shareholders, and be good stewards, you know, in our community. That, I think that's the fundamental question. And so if I were a board member, you know, those are the kinds of things that I would be looking for. The second thing is, you mentioned the response of the local responsiveness, and I appreciate the fact that you've got very stable corporate management, senior management. I don't think I've ever, you know, certainly the other companies, I don't think, can say that they've got their senior management team with 15 years, you've been together 15 years. I mean, if you look around the country and the CEO turnover in facilities, it's 30% or higher. It's getting worse, though. CEOs are just throwing up their hands and says, I don't want to deal with this anymore, with the uncertainties of the marketplace and the ACA and all that, but for whatever reason. But I think for the community, it's important for the local, for that local connection to be there. And, you know, I've worked in the investor-owned side, you know, the not-for-profit side, teaching, non-teaching. So, you know, I cut my teeth basically on operating hospitals on the investor-owned side, and that's where they're really, really good. But it's when you're a facility administrator or a facility CFO, it's different. It's a different job than being a CEO or a CFO of an independent standalone hospital with total responsibility for treasury management, strategy, et cetera, et cetera. In some ways, it's kind of lonely because you don't have those resources to draw upon, you know, from you know, a system. But nevertheless, it's a different job. And some people are willing to do those kinds of jobs, and some people are not, and are well suited for that. So the second part of my question is, speak to the CEO turnover. It's great that you've got that stability in the corporate management. Speak to the CEO turnover in your facility administrators in your company. So that said, I'll shut up.
I'm trying to decide, Steve, which question to go for first. Let me talk, I'll talk about the senior management. I told you about our tenure. Well, tenure's fine, but what's the performance? I think if you go and talk to A.J. Rice at UBS, you talk to Frank Morgan, they're going to tell you that consistently CHS has the best performance. Okay, that's good. Now, what other things can you tell me about your performance? Well, for 7 out of the last 8 years, Institutional Investor has rated Wayne Smith the number one CEO in the healthcare sector.
He's a fellow Trinity grad, so I'm not going to say anything bad about him. Good guy.
For 8 out of the last 9 years, Institutional Investor has rated Larry Cash the number one CEO in the healthcare sector. That's CFO, excuse me. So that speaks to the caliber of leadership in this company. It's not only tenure, it's performance above and beyond what everybody else is delivering. You mentioned the treasury function. We just completed in the last year approximately $9.4 billion of refinancing. We did that refinancing and effectively reduced our average interest rate by 1 percentage point. The expertise that we have, the ability that we have to borrow money cheaply. You talked about the size of your GPO versus the GPO that we're a party to. That's only one part of the equation. The other part of the equation is, what's the compliance with the GPO contracts? HPG has the best compliance with contracts of anybody in the country. That's why we have the best price, because we have our members buying into the concept of using the national vendors. So there clearly is opportunity with supply management. I suggest to you that probably our overall salary and wage cost is more like 38% to 39%. So we think there's probably a little bit of opportunity there. To your question about CEO turnover, I'll just speak to my division. I would say that we probably lose 10 to 15% per year at the most. I learned from my 22 years at Humana how important it was to grow and prepare young talent for succession. Every time this year that I've had a promotion, I've only lost one person from the company. I was able to put in another person that was in the CHS organization who was trained in CHS and Division I culture to get the job done. So CEO turnover in our division is not an issue at all. We have in Division I the highest employee satisfaction, the highest patient satisfaction, the highest physician satisfaction in our entire company. So I think we're probably doing something right, and I think we do add value to those facilities which we affiliate with.
Okay, any other questions? Larry?
Big concern is CapEx. And I heard the comment that we can always reduce the offer to increase the CapEx. Currently, Monroe is putting in $20 to $25 million a year in CapEx. We have buildings on the property that are 50 years old. Our newest is the towers, which is approaching the 10-year period. We're getting to be an aging structure. If we don't have CapEx investment, we can't grow the other services that are needed. So just from one trustee, I have a problem with your commitment to CapEx going forward.
Well, again, we've not seen your plan yet, and we've not seen your pricing. I think once we have access to those things, we'll be able to more firmly tell you what the specific dollar amount would be. Again, restating on the routine, minimum of 10. You've asked for 15. Now, my information might be wrong, but we've gone back for about 5 or 6 years, and I'm not sure that you've spent quite the amount, the 5 or 6% that I think was the target each of those years. My numbers might be wrong, but that's what I was told. Again, the $150 million master plan, I've not seen it yet, so I can't comment is that the right thing to do or the wrong thing to do. I do understand that you have an aging facility. I understand that you're landlocked on 10 acres of land here, and that a major capital infusion has to occur for this hospital to be successful for the long term. I don't have enough detail today to tell you I will spend $150 million over the next 10 years on major projects. I'm sorry, but again, with the ability, if we can go back and restructure the proposal, if you like, but our initial offering price for this facility is $40 million higher than Life Point. Well, if you spend $40 million more on the front end, then there's going to be less on the back end to invest in the property. It's that simple. It may not be a message you want to hear, but as I said, the franchise has a certain value, and it's going to be capped, and however you package it, the dollar's not going to be a whole lot different.
Okay, well, David, I appreciate it. We're not here to drill down on any one specific subject, so we do appreciate your comments, and Larry, appropriate questions. Any other specific questions we have? And then we do thank everybody for the information. It was very informative. At this stage, we'll go to any public comment. I did not have anyone who had requested to speak, but that doesn't preclude anybody who would like to say some comments. Okay, without any public comment, I would just like to wrap up this portion and thank you for the information. You got a great organization, interesting information, and we're just excited that you're down here. So I want to thank you on behalf of the Strategic Options Committee, management, and our community at large. So thank you very much. We're going to take about a 5 to 10 minute break at the most after this, and then we'll reconvene for some just general briefing.